Bantam Audio Publishing presents Private Eyes by Jonathan Kellerman. A therapist's work is never over, which isn't to say that patients don't get better, but the bond forged when private eyes peek into private lives can achieve a certain immortality. Some patients leave and never return. Some never leave. Many occupy an ambiguous space in the middle, throwing out occasional tendrils of reattachment during periods of pride or sorrow. So I really wasn't surprised when I came home after a July night run and learned that Melissa Dickinson had left a message with my service. First time I'd heard from her in, what, it had to be nearly 10 years. Melissa left therapy after 2 years, a changed little girl. I allowed myself a bit of self-congratulation, but knew better than to wallow in it, because the family structure that had nurtured her problems had never been altered. Despite that, there'd been no reason to keep her in treatment against her will. "I'm 9 years old, Dr. Delaware," she'd said. "I'm ready to handle things on my own." Now, all these years later, I glanced at the number she'd left with the service, an 818 area code, San Labrador exchange. I dug into my closed files and found her chart, same prefix as her original home number, but the last 4 digits were different. Change of number, or had she left home? If she had, she hadn't gone very far. I checked the date of her last session, 9 years ago, a birth date in June. She'd turned 18 a month ago. I wondered why I hadn't heard from her sooner. The phone was picked up after 2 rings. "Hello?" The voice of a stranger, young, female. "Melissa, this is Dr. Alex Delaware."
"Oh, hi. Thanks so much for calling back. I didn't know if you were still in practice. The answering service said you were, but that you worked mostly with lawyers and judges."
"Well, yeah, that's basically true, but I'm always available to former patients, and I'm glad you called. How are things, Melissa?"
"Things are good," she said quickly. "Having said that, the logical question is, why am I calling you after all these years, right? And the answer is that it's not about me, Dr. Delaware. It's Mother. Do you think I could come and see you?"
I checked my book. "How about tomorrow at noon?" I gave her directions to my house. She thanked me and hung up before I could complete my goodbye. A bright young woman, articulate, tense. "It's Mother," she'd said. That opened up a realm of possibilities. The most likely, she'd finally come to grips with her mother's pathology, what it meant to her. Needed to put her feelings in focus, maybe get a referral for her mother. So tomorrow's visit would probably be a one-shot deal. And that would be it, for another 9 years. I spent the next couple of hours on my latest project, a monograph for one of the psych journals on my experiences with a school full of children victimized by a sniper the previous autumn. At 11:30, I put my pen down and sat back. My eyes fell on Melissa's chart. I opened it and began reading. October 18th, 1978. I'd just given grand rounds at Western Hospital and was on my way out of the lecture hall when a young woman stopped me. "Dr. Delaware, Eileen Wagner." She had a pleasant, full face under cropped chestnut hair. Her blouse was mannish and buttoned to the neck. We shook hands. She said, "You gave a lecture on fears to the Four West staff last year when I was PL3. I thought it was quite good. I enjoyed today, too, and I've got a referral for you if you're interested." "Sure," I said. She shifted her Gladstone bag to another hand. "I'm in practice now out in Pasadena, have privileges at Cathcart Memorial. But the kid I have in mind isn't one of my regular patients, just a phone-in through Cathcart's helpline. She was so young, the volunteer on the phone could hardly believe his ears. They didn't know how to handle it and sent it over to me. When I heard what the problem was, I thought it would be right up your alley." "I'd be happy to help, Dr. Wagner, but my office is on the other side of town."
"No matter. They'll come to you. They have the means. I know because I went out a few days ago to see her. It's a little girl we're talking about, 7 years old. She's just racked with fears, multiple phobias, as well as general anxiety.
When you say you went there, you mean a house call?
She smiled. Didn't think anyone did them anymore, huh? I don't make a habit of it. Wanted them to come to the office, but that's part of the problem. They don't travel. Or rather, the mother doesn't. She's an agoraphobic. Hasn't left her house for years.
What did she tell you about the kid? I asked.
Just that Melissa, that's her name, was afraid of everything. The dark, loud noises and bright lights, being alone, new situations, and she often seems tense and jumpy. I'm sure some of it's the way she lives. It's a very strange situation. Big house, huge, acres of land, dutiful servants, and the mother stays up in her room like some Victorian princess. She's really beautiful. Despite the fact that one side of her face is a mesh of fine scars, I'd be willing to bet she had top-level plastic surgery years ago for something really major. Maybe that's the root of her problem. I don't know.
She doesn't leave the house at all? I asked.
No. When I suggested she see if she could make it to my office, she started to get really tense, so I backed off. But she did agree to have Melissa be seen by a psychologist.
Do you think the mother really wants help?
For the girl? She says she does. I told her I'd be talking to a psychologist. A servant could bring the girl to your office.
Is there a father in the picture?
No, she's a widow. It happened when Melissa was a baby. Heart attack. I got the impression he was a much older man. Anyway, here's the relevant data. She handed me a piece of paper. I saw patients all that afternoon, finished a stack of charts, then cleared my desk and phoned the number Eileen Wagner had written down. A reedy male voice answered.
Dickinson residence?
Mrs. Dickinson, please. This is Dr. Delaware regarding Melissa.
Mrs. Dickinson's not available, Doctor. However, she said to tell you that Melissa can be at your office any weekday between 3 and 4:30.
I checked my appointment book. How about Wednesday, 4 o'clock? But I would like to talk with Mrs. Dickinson before the appointment.
I'll inform her of that, Doctor.
Who'll be bringing Melissa?
I will, sir.
And you are?
Dutchie. Jacob Dutchie. I'm in Mrs. Dickinson's employ.
The next morning, an envelope arrived by messenger. Inside was a sheet of rose-colored stationery folded over a check. The check was for $3,000 and was annotated Medical Treatment for Melissa. At my 78 rate, over 40 sessions worth. At the top of the stationery, embossed black script read, Regina Paddock Dickinson. Below that, she had written in a fine, graceful hand, Dear Dr. Delaware, thank you for seeing Missy. I'll be in touch. Faithfully yours, Gina Dickinson. I dialed the Dickinson residence. This time a woman answered, Gallic accent, different pipes, same song, Madame wasn't available. No, she had no idea when Madame would be available. I left my name, hung up, looked at the check. All those digits. Treatment hadn't even begun, and I'd lost control. Dutchie was 50-ish and plump. He had on a well-cut but old-fashioned blue suit. When I came out of the inner office on Wednesday at 4, he and the girl were standing in the waiting room. The girl clutched his hand as if he were Santa Claus. She was small for her age, had an oval face just this side of pretty, beneath bangs the color of walnut shells. The rest of her hair was long and topped with a pink-flowered band. I introduced myself, bending and smiling at the girl. She stared back. To my surprise, no terror.
I'll be off now, Dutchie announced. 45 minutes.
I was bracing myself for resistance, but the girl gave him what appeared to be a reassuring smile.
Bye, Jacob, she said.
After the door closed, I said, Looks like Jacob's a good friend. She said, He's my mother's retainer. She doesn't leave the house, so Jacob does lots of things for us. I've got toys in my office, I said. How about we go check them out?
She allowed me to usher her into the consult room. Once she was inside, she started knitting her hands. I walked over to the toy cabinet, opened it, and pointed. I've got lots of stuff in here. Games and dolls and clay. Paper and pencil, too, and crayons if you like to draw in color. Why
should I do? We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.